Hi, and welcome to Fairy Range Focus. This month, we're going to be bringing you some information on our new electronic health record. I'm Deb Boardman, I'm the President and CEO of Fairy Range, and I'll be moderating your session today. With us today, we have Jessica Valento, our Information Systems Manager, and Carrie Petrich, who is our Clinic Electronic Medical Record Systems Administrator for Fairy Range. So let's get started and talk about what an electronic medical record is. Why don't we start by just telling people, what is it?
Well, it really offers us a computer system that will allow us to put all of the clinical information in one spot. So it can take notes from a provider such as a physician or a nurse and contain that in there, as well as take in records from the lab system or from radiology, and gives us a central place to store all the information that can then be accessible from wherever we have a location that's in need of getting to that. So our clinics or the hospital.
So you can access it from any site.
Right.
That might play into the next question about why are all healthcare systems moving to electronic records?
Mm-hmm. Really, it gives us a way to just do that. I mean, get to it from anywhere, as well as it saves us time and ultimately cost for healthcare to run paper records around everywhere. It gives us a way to have that accessible wherever we need it. We no longer have a provider who is going to be looking for that chart and spending time when we really need them to be at the bedside with that patient. This way they've got a computer in the room, they can pull it right up, they have access to all that they need, they know which medications and everything that the patient has. So that gives us, the biggest part of why people are moving to these. But then there's other reasons as far as government requirements and different things like that.
So Carrie, does that mean the paper is eventually all gonna go away?
It will. It will. The paper will go away, whether it will be electronic form, and that would be where the provider would be inputting the information, or the nurses, or also it would be scanned into the electronic chart. So that eventually the paper will go away.
Not right away, but over time.
Over time.
Right? Over time. So what system? I'm sure there are many systems out there that people could choose from. Different healthcare organizations have a variety of different systems. What system did Fairy Range choose and why did they choose it?
We chose Epic, and really this is where we can take advantage of our partnership with Fairview, because they had a very robust electronic medical record system already in place. It's one that we wouldn't be able to get as a small hospital and clinic healthcare system on our own. We had to partner with somebody to be able to get to this. So though we could have had another electronic medical record, that it would have been smaller and not had as many capabilities. So this really offers us a chance to be on one of the best that's in the country, and it's something that's really becoming a standard in the area. Many systems throughout Minnesota are using this, and it also offers us the chance with a patient's consent, we can even query those other locations. So we can ask from Essentia to send records over to our system as long as that patient has given consent, which if we look at a situation like somebody coming into our ER, that could be a life or death situation. We need access to know what medication was that person just put on, and the person maybe doesn't remember exactly what it was. They can give consent to say, pull my records from another location. So it gives us a lot of capabilities.
If you are a Fairview patient at another location, how does that work?
If you're at another Fairview location, it makes it even easier because we're using the same platform. So really we can access those records right away. When a patient first comes in to our clinics or our hospital location, we do explain that we're using a shared record, and we give them the opportunity to sign a consent form that allows us to share that between the different locations.
So for example, if someone who lives in the Twin Cities is up here on vacation and needs to come into the emergency room or urgent care, their records are available to those mm-hmm. providers.
Right, it's at their fingertips right away.
Well, that's great. Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about the effect that this is having on our patients. What kind of things, how does this impact their visit when they come to the clinic, for example?
Sure, what it affects right now is that with implementing a new system, we have a little bit longer wait times. So with those wait times, the reason why is because we're switching over the system. We were able to preload some information But then we only have some information that we're able to gain when the patient walks through the door. So the first time that you're seen and you're on the new system, it does take a little bit of time for us to get the information in. But once we have the information in, the second and third time that you come in should be a lot faster.
So what's the process when a person comes in if they haven't given their information? What happens?
There's a series of questions that have to be answered before. So whether we get that when you make the appointment, if you call ahead of time and make your appointment, we're able to get all of that information preloaded. But if we're not having some information, then we do have to get that information from you. Whether that's scanning in your driver's license or scanning in your insurance card, we need to get that information before the patient's seen by the doctor.
One of the questions I often get asked is, why do we ask for the same information every time when a person visits? Has that process changed? Do we still ask the same information every time?
We will verify the patient information, so we still want to verify that you're still at the same residency or you still have the same phone number, just so we make sure that we have the most accurate information on file for you. And some insurance companies, they might change, or some employers might change insurances, so we really want to make sure that we have the most information up to date that's on file for you, so we don't have to call you back and ask you for your updated information or get that information after your visit.
Great. So when we have the information that comes from outside facilities and we get them in, what happens with that information? How do we get it into our system?
Well, there's a couple of things that we might do. If it's information that we feel is critical to have within the record, then we might hand enter some of that. Maybe it's information about a test result. If it's a diabetic patient, they went to another facility to get a lab test done. We want to make sure that the provider can see that on the lab screen and has all of that blended with the data that we already have. If it's more of a reference point where we just want the provider or a nurse to be able to just take a look at the document, we might scan it in. We always make sure that all of the information that we're receiving is put into the record in some way, but whether it's hand entering or scanning, those are a couple of ways we might get it in there.
So Carrie, again, talking specifically about the clinic, you talked a little bit about how a patient's visit is different when they come in to register. How is it different when they get back to the room to actually see the nurse and the physician? What's different than before?
Well, prior to Epic, we were on an electronic medical record. So we were asking that information and we were capturing that data electronically. So when we moved to the Epic system, now since the clinic and the hospital are on the same Epic system, we're asking the information that we weren't able to transfer over, so we might re-ask the information. We did take a look at our patients and know that if you answered one question before, we want to try and make sure that we don't ask you again. So we do have a team of people that are looking at that information and trying to load it in prior to the patient visit. Now, if you're a patient that you haven't been seen and you just walk in, we might have to ask you that information again. But the scheduled patient visits, we really try to get that information in the system ahead of time.
And from the hospital side, Jessica, we didn't have electronic medical records before,
right?
Really, right?
Mm-hmm.
So people are seeing a big change there.
Oh, definitely. And that goes back to having to load all of that information. That first visit to the hospital side, you're going to get asked a lot of things that we may not have been able to capture in the same way before. And we always want to make sure that we have the most current information.
So when a person is a patient in the hospital now, do they actually have a computer in their room as they're taking care of them to document things?
That's right. All of our rooms in the hospital will have a computer available for the clinicians to use. And then throughout the facility, if people had taken a look at what we had at our nurses' stations before, they'll notice there's an explosion of computers all over, including workstations on wheels, so carts that are able to move around, or tablets that people may be carrying.
So it's changing pretty fast.
It is.
Changing
yes.
pretty fast. So now that a lot of our information is electronic, are there any concerns about safety or security of that information?
That's a question that I think a lot of people have when they first hear that everything is moving toward being electronic. But really, Fairview takes this very seriously, that we keep our network secure, we keep our systems secure. There's an entire team of people down at Fairview that actually, that's their focus, is making sure that there are no ways to get in from the outside without the authorized accounts. So when we have a new employee come on, we take a look at their role, we assign them security within the system, so basically they're given a password to get into the system, and we make sure that it's the minimum necessary to do their job. So of course a nurse is going to be able to see all of the vitals and different things. A provider is going to be able to see past medical history and different things. But if it's somebody, say, working in our housekeeping area, maybe they only need to know information about when a bed is needing to be cleaned and not everybody's medical information. So we limit their access to that. And we also do audits periodically, actually quite continuously, just as a double check to make sure everybody is accessing things appropriately. And we look at data in different ways. And there are ways that we can put additional security on a patient record. If say we had somebody who was, usually in the media, if there was a high profile person coming in, we could stick additional security measures on there that say every time this chart is accessed, we need to add an additional reason why this person is going into that chart. And then we have a log of all of that.
And I assume just like we're supposed to do with our home computer, there's a lot of backup going on.
Oh, definitely. Yes, there. We have redundant connections down to the actual corporate location, and at corporate they have a large backup plan, and there's a disaster recovery site as well. So if the system were to go down, we have an ability to fail over to another location.
So hopefully a lot of copies.
Yes.
Hopefully a lot of copies. Yes. So now that all this is in place, what comes next?
I don't know that we feel like it's ever over, because there's always something that's evolving. There's new modules we may be using or different ways that we might feed information in from a system. I know we've talked about radiation therapy. That's another one that we have that we'd like to look at ways of interconnecting those systems. And then we also have the things that are available for our patients.
And that's one of our next projects, correct?
We've got it going right now that we have MyChart available to our patients.
So let's talk a little bit about that. What does that bring for a patient?
So within the Epic system, we are able to offer our patients now a tool called MyChart. And what it is it's able to have a patient access their information electronically. So the information that we have electronically are lab and x-ray results. We have immunizations. Within the MyChart, you can also request an appointment for your provider, and you can also ask a question of your care team. So the information that we have right now in the system, as we had mentioned earlier, is that we're evolving, we're getting the information preloaded. So there's only certain information that we have current right now in our system, which would reflect the same information in MyChart. So we do have a team of individuals that are taking and hand entering the information. So over time, we will have all the information loaded for our patients, and so they can have the most up-to-date information.
So people will be able to access this on their own medical record?
Yep. What the patients will do is they'll be able to access it via their own personal computer, or they can also access it via their electronic device. The smartphones, you're able to access your MyChart as well. So so the sky's the limit for the MyChart.
Yep. It creates a secure connection, kind of like if someone was accessing a bank account online. It's the same type of security that's in place that allows them to do that from any location.
So how does a person go about setting that up?
Sure, you can look us up in the phone book and call the main line, the telephone number for Fairview Range, and ask for health information. Health information will then send out a authorization, and you can fill that out. And if you send it back, what happens is then we do send an authorization, a code for the patient, so that when you go on MyChart, then you'll enter this code in, and then you're able to set up a username and password. You also can visit our website, and then we do have the authorization under the MyChart, and you can print out that authorization at home and then send it, and we can start that process there.
When people can come in for appointments, can they set it up when they're there for an appointment, or is that something we don't offer at this time?
Yep, that's the other form of setting up through MyChart. You can, when you're during a visit, we can have our nurse set up, and it takes just a couple of minutes for you to get access, and then we'll write down your access code for you, and then you can go home at your leisure and be able to look up the information.
Great. So it's as simple as going on the web and going onto the Fairview website, I assume.
And there's a form available on there.
Okay.
Doing it in the appointment is probably the quickest way, because I know setting up my own account maybe took under a minute.
Yeah.
So it was no time at all.
So let's talk a little bit about, in my case, I have elderly parents that I go to their clinic appointments and help them a lot with that. Would I, as their adult child, be able to access their records?
Yes, you can sign up as or have someone signed up as a proxy on your account, so they would be able to give the authorization to have you access their account from anywhere again. So, definitely.
And then on the flip side, are parents able to access their children's accounts?
Yeah, in the same way, we are able to sign up. It's 0 to 12. Mm-hmm. You're able to sign up and get access to the accounts. So, like, I have three children that are 6, 8, and 10, and I can sign up and be on any of their accounts. Now, when they hit 13, I think.
13 to 17, the patient has to sign up. We almost consider them the minor. So they'll sign up, and then they'll also have the physician's signature to say, yes, they can have it. And then once they get their own access, they can give their parents access. So they'll be able to view that information. But that's the 13 to 17-year-old mark.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There are some people certainly still who don't have computers or who aren't computer savvy and don't feel comfortable with that. So this won't be the only means by which people can access their information, I assume.
They can always still come into our health information department and request a copy of their records. Mm-hmm. That availability will stay.
Given the scenario that you just gave with your parents, we do scenarios like this quite a bit with the elderly patients that come in and say their children live out of state. We say, even though you don't have a computer, if you sign up for MyChart and then you give access for your child to be able to access your information, it's a better way for the parent to communicate to the child exactly what, or the adult child, exactly what happened during that visit. So they don't have to sit and remember exactly what the physician says. So if they sign up, then their child is able to sign up and get their information.
Oh, that's a great thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
For sure. I assume there are many more other capabilities out there that are yet to come down the road. You hear it every day. I was at a conference recently where they were showcasing some of the things where people would wear a little patch and it would monitor their heart rate that would automatically transmit to their clinics or wherever mm-hmm. they choose to have that send. So I know there's a lot of things in development out there. When some of that technology comes down the road, will that be able to link directly with our medical records?
Definitely. As things are developed, we'll be adding more and more all the time. Just like right now, we are able to use the vitals that we're capturing in the hospital rooms, and it's transferring directly into the patient's record. So I can definitely see how, as this develops and that becomes available, we'll do the same type of interface and put it into the medical record from home. There are a lot of capabilities that we'll have down the road.
You know, it's an interesting aside to the conversation today, but do you have a guesstimate of how many computers we actually have?
We have right around 1,000 computers.
And do you know how many we have in the clinic?
Wow.
A lot.
Yeah. A lot. Well, yeah. Because every exam room is equipped with a computer as well yeah. as all the employees. So yeah. whether they have a desktop or a laptop that's portable. Yeah.
We're talking hundreds, definitely.
Yeah. So.
When we went through this process to put all of this system in, as you say, it wasn't just training people how to use the system, but it was linking all of our electronic equipment, all of the anesthesia monitoring equipment, mm-hmm. all of the blood pressure monitoring equipment, all of that, everything is all interfaced with this. So anything that you have measured electronically in the entire organization goes into the record, correct?
Mm-hmm. Right, yes. That was a huge part of it, was just getting that communication down so we make sure that it is a solid system that we can rely on.
So when you talk specifically about MyChart, what do you see in the years to come down the road with that? How might that change, or additional benefits that might come with that?
Well, there's some capabilities that we know we'd like to use in the future, such as e-visits or maybe doing a direct schedule right into for an appointment. So those are some things right on the horizon that we see, but not available in it yet.
So just to remind folks, what we said today is that MyChart is up, and that if you have an interest in signing up, you can do that now. Mm-hmm. If you've been in and been a patient, you can access it by calling, by going online, or talking to your provider when you're there for a visit, correct?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Great. Anything else about the electronic record you'd like to share with our viewers today?
No, it's just, you know, it's nice to finally have it here and be live. We were waiting for this day for a long time.
A lot of preparation and work.
Lots of preparation. It was worth it, though.
Yes. Definitely. Well, and a lot of time and effort on your part. We appreciate that greatly.
Thank you.
Well, that's our show for today. A special thank you to Jessica and Carrie for their time and joining us today. If you have any topics that you'd like us to report on at our monthly program, if you could just contact us at 362-6771 and talk to the folks there and give them your feedback. We'd love to hear it and see what we can do to bring the information to you in a future show. Thanks so much, and that's our segment for today.